I'm not usually a big fan of email forwards. I usually like people's own words, you know. There's a lot of people who just forward me emails. But I do enjoy certain kinds of them. And some of the ones that I do enjoy are ones that come from my friend who's got a very similar sense of humor to me. And so he'll forward me emails whenever he finds stories about someone who's done something really, really foolish. Like those stories that will pop up in the news from time to time about people who have done really, really foolish things. I want to share just a few of them with you. One is of this teenager from Belgium. And this came out a few years ago. And she was in the news because she had 56 star tattoos tattooed across the side of her face. 56. But she says, she actually tried to sue the tattoo artist because she says that she told him to just put a few up here toward the top of her head and that she fell asleep and she only woke up when he was tattooing her nose. Turns out that she was lying, that she actually did order all 56 tattoos on the side of her face. Foolish teenager. Another one, another story that I thought was funny was a lady was coming out of a department store and she gets her purse snatched, but she gets a good glimpse of the guy who took her purse, and so she immediately calls 911. There was a cop in the area, and so they were able to get this guy like almost immediately. And so the cop pulls back up to the department store where the lady just was, and the perpetrator's in the back of the car. He gets the thief out of the back of the squad car, and he says, "Can you make an identification for me?" And the thief pipes up, and he says, "Yes, sir, I can. That's the woman whose purse I stole." Foolish thief. And then, really one of my favorites is of a college student in Germany, and he was wanting to go visit his girlfriend in Australia. She lived in Sydney, Australia. And so he was going to go visit her over the holiday and spend a couple of weeks with her. He booked airline tickets. He gets off the plane, and he's surprised that it was only like 40 degrees outside, not what he expected for Sydney, Australia. Turns out he was in Sydney, Montana. He's in Sydney, Montana, and his own words, he said something to the effect of, "You know, I got a little suspicious when we began flying over the United States, but I thought, well, you can get to Australia from Germany through the United States." And his mom says, "You know, I trusted that he knew what he was doing. He's usually very good with computers." Foolish German. I think I like these stories, though. I like them because they're in a way kind of comforting, because I do dumb stuff a lot, you know, and I think about all the bonehead things that I've done, and I'm just glad that they haven't, you know, been forwarded to a million people because they were reported in the news somewhere. The truth is we all do foolish things from time to time, and we have foolish beliefs from time to time. Everyone, I think, is guilty of believing foolishly at one time or another. And there's a lot of people who have foolish beliefs about God. They think of God as like kind of like a genie in the sky or something, you know. All they have to do is kind of make a wish, say a prayer, and their wish comes true. Or all the people who fall for the foolish belief that if we have enough faith, we're going to be rich and we're going to be healthy all the time. And those are all foolish beliefs. And of course, Paul, in the book of Galatians, he's writing this letter to the Galatians, as we've seen over the past several weeks, because they have foolish beliefs. And what they've begun to do is they've begun to basically raise up rules and regulations, or believe that this is the case. There's false teachers called the Judaizers who were teaching them this. And they're raising up these rules and regulations above faith in Jesus Christ. And Paul, in Galatians 3, and if you got your Bible, go ahead and turn there right now. That's where we're going to be today, is in Galatians 3. He actually calls them foolish Galatians. He knows that they're foolish. He knows exactly how foolish they are, because he knows that rules and regulations don't get you anywhere. That, as he calls them, works don't get you anywhere, and that really our hope is only in Christ. And so that's really what we're going to see throughout this passage, is him making the argument that Christ alone is our hope. Christ alone is our hope. Now, as we continue to look through the book of Galatians, Paul repeats himself a lot. He continues to come back to this, Christ alone, Christ alone, Christ alone. It's not by what you do, it's by your faith. And we've seen it a lot, and today he just hammers it home. And he says it a lot, and so we hear it coming out a lot in my messages, because I'm preaching straight from Galatians. But I'm going to argue that that's good for us, that really we should wake up every day and remind ourselves, it's Christ alone. It's Christ alone. So Christ alone is our hope. Let's go ahead and dive into this first verse where he calls them foolish. In verse 1 of Galatians chapter 3, he says, "You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was portrayed as crucified." Foolish Galatians. Again, he knows that this is a foolish belief. "Who has bewitched you?" It's like they've been entranced, hypnotized by these false teachers. Who's tricked you here? Who has bewitched you? Who has entranced you? What he's saying is, I clearly taught you Christ crucified. What he's saying there is, I clearly taught you the gospel, which is that Christ crucified is everything for you. That it's by his death that you're saved. And that's it. I clearly taught that to you. You're foolish if you're believing something else. So as he begins to make this argument, in chapter 1 and 2, what we've seen is him focusing on the argument, for the most part, that he's an apostle, that he can be believed, that he didn't get this gospel somewhere else, that he got it from God, that he's a true apostle. That's the argument he's been making. And now as we get into Galatians 3, we see his argument shift a little bit into more of a theological argument, an argument coming from God's point of view. This is what Scripture teaches us. This is what Scripture has always taught God's people. And this, my brothers and sisters in Galatia, is what you've already experienced. You've experienced this stuff. You see it in Scriptures. And so this is what you should believe. So he really begins diving into this theological argument that we're going to see here. By the way, you've got in your bulletin, you've got notes if you want to use them. I realize what I told Kathy, this is really text heavy today, that we get through, we try to cover a lot of text today, and there's some kind of deep stuff here. And so I thought maybe, I know for me, I would need something to help me stay focused. So if you're like me, then you can use those notes to help you stay focused. But we see him diving into this argument, and really it revolves around this instruction: live by faith, not by works. Live by your faith in Christ, not by the rules and regulations and all this other stuff. Live only by faith. And so as we focus on the argument to live by faith, we see here Paul dive in and to verse 2 into this argument, and he asks 5 rhetorical questions, like right away. Boom, 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 boom. And it's as if he's like, I know you already know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask you anyway because you need to reflect on this. You need to be reminded of these things. So here we go, verse 2. It says, I'd like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law, or by believing what you heard? And that believing what you heard, that's quite literally, it's like believing with trust. And that's where faith comes from, by believing and trusting what you heard. Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? Have you experienced so much in vain, if it really was in vain? So again, I ask, does God give you his Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law, or by your believing what you heard? He's saying, look, it's obvious you guys are Christians. You've got the Holy Spirit. We've seen him work among you. We've seen miracles done among you. Where'd you get it? Did you get it by what you did? Did you get it by following all these rules and regulations? And he wants them to answer in their head, no. And so he's saying, well, are you now trying to continue or finish your faith, finish this race? Are you trying to hold on to this Christianity now? By rules and regulations or by faith then? And he wants them to understand, oh, it's faith that got me here, and it's faith that I should continue by. It's not these, I shouldn't be trying to live by these rules and regulations now, but by faith only. And what we see here, really, is him coming to this conclusion. You were saved through your faith, so you're sustained through your faith. Your faith is what saved you, so your faith is what sustains you. It's what keeps you going as a Christian. Read a story about a pastor who got in an airplane, and after the plane took off, it's in the air for a few minutes, he looks over and he sees this little, like, 3 or 4 year old boy, like across the aisle from him, and he's doing, this little 3 or 4 year old boy is doing this. He's flying the plane, right? He's doing this, but he notices that this kid is really persistent, and like 5 minutes later, this kid's still doing this. And then the kid's mom looks at him, and she begins to notice him doing this, and she asks him, you know, what are you doing? And she realizes at that time, and the pastor realizes at this time, this kid is almost hysterical. He's very, very upset. So I was like, well, what's wrong? What are you doing? And he's like, I'm flying the plane, and if I stop, we're going to crash. Somehow this kid got it in his head that he was the one responsible for keeping the plane in the air. Now his little three or four-year-old mind probably couldn't reason this way, but if he could have, maybe he could have asked himself, hey, kid, did I get this plane in the air? Well, was it me who was responsible for getting the plane in the air in the first place? Well, no, then I must not be flying it. Or he could ask himself this question. Can I fly by myself? No. So what makes me think that I can fly this airplane? If he could have reasoned it through, he would have realized, well, no, I can't be flying the plane on my own, by myself. But think about it. That's what a lot of Christians, we fall for this belief that we understand that we're saved by faith, that all we had to do to become a Christian was put our faith in Christ. But then, sometimes we begin living by the belief that there's all these things that we have to do, and we have to do this and don't do that, and that's what keeps us saved. That's what keeps the plane in the air. And like the kid, we maybe should ask ourselves, is that what got us flying in the first place? The rules and the regulations, the do this, don't do that, is that what got us saved in the first place? No. Then that's not what makes us continue as Christians. That's not what sustains our faith. So we see that we were saved through our faith, and therefore we're sustained, we keep going through our faith. We also see in this passage, and Paul argues to the Galatians, he tells them, hey, you became a child of Abraham through your faith. You became a child of Abraham through your faith. In verse 6, he says, so also Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. This is really important. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. This directly opposed what the Judaizers were teaching. Remember their teaching? They were teaching that to really put your faith in Christ, to really become a Christian, you got to be circumcised if you're a guy. You've got to obey all these Jewish food laws. You got to follow all these Jewish ceremonies and rituals and celebrations. And so they were teaching that you have to do these things to become saved. Well, Paul, he goes all the way back to Abraham, really the father of the Hebrews, Father Abraham. He takes it back to Abraham and he says, look, Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. His belief caused him to be righteous, not anything else. His belief caused him to be righteous. So he goes straight, Paul goes straight to Scripture to oppose the Judaizers. And then he continues in verse 7, understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. So if we put our faith in Christ, then we, because Abraham was faithful and it was credited to him as righteousness, then if we are faithful, then we become his children. His children also have that same deal. We believe and is credited to him, to us, as righteous. And this is big because this puts us in God's family. This is what Paul's argument is, puts us in God's family. Remember, the Jews, they looked at themselves always as God's chosen people, right? Well, how did they get that way? By putting their faith in God. That's what makes them a true member of God's family. And so putting our faith in God, it makes us a true member of God's family by making us a child of Abraham. And then third, he argues that you receive then the blessing that's promised to the children of Abraham. Since you are children of Abraham, you get the promise that they get through faith. Verses 8 and 9. Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, would make innocent the people who weren't Jewish by faith, and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. So this whole deal with Abraham, let me just remind you about the whole story. God's story here takes us back to Genesis 12, and Abraham is called out by God, and God says, hey, Abraham, leave all this stuff behind and go to this land, go to this place that I'm going to show you, and I'm going to bless you. And I'm going to make you famous. I'm going to make your name great. And I'm going to give you all this land. And so these promises were given to Abraham. And then later, Abraham's offspring were given the same promises. His descendants, his kids, were given the same promises. And so that's the promise, is that we'll be blessed. I will bless you. That's the main promise. And so we could sum this up. We could talk. We could spend 30 minutes talking just about, well, what is this blessing that we now receive from God? What is the blessing that Abraham truly got? And what is the blessing that Abraham's kids truly got? Isaac and Jacob and all of them. What did they truly get? Really, we could sum it up by saying, God promised this. I will be your God, and you will be my people. We get God as our shepherd, as our protector, as our guide, as the one who loves us. We're adopted into God's family. He's our father. That's the blessing. So as Abraham's kids, because we're Abraham's kids, we get this blessing. And we're only Abraham's kids by faith, not by these rules and regulations. So Paul, so far, he has made a good argument for what's so important about faith. What is it about faith that gets us this recognition before God? And so we've seen that, but now Paul continues the argument, and we kind of get to see the other side of it. We kind of get to see, well, why not works? Why not rules and regulations? Why not better safe than sorry? And so let's go with the Judaizers. They believed that Jesus died for them. They believed all that, and they just threw all this other stuff with it. Yeah, believe in Jesus and get circumcised and follow the food laws and do all these things. So why not do all this stuff too and believe that, well, maybe that's going to get us somewhere with God. Maybe that's going to earn us special status with God. And so Paul goes with this argument, and he continues with it. And we see that, first of all, that if we rely on that, relying on works, relying on those rules and regulations, ultimately it makes you cursed, is what he argues. Verses 10 through 14, he says, for all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. As it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Clearly, no one who relies on the law is justified before God, because the righteous will live by what? By faith, not by what they do. The righteous will live by faith. The law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says, the person who does these things will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. It's written, cursed is everyone who's hung on a pole. Christ was hung on a pole and became that curse for us, to take that curse for us. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Paul's arguing here. And notice how he went to how many different scriptures? Three or four different scriptures. Now remember, for us, that's the Old Testament. For them, it was just scripture. There was no New Testament yet. Paul was living out the New Testament as we spoke. And writing the letter to Galatians, which became part of the New Testament. But so he's referring to scripture to make this argument. But his argument is, look, you can't rely on these rules, on these regulations, on these do this, don't do that. You can't rely on it to get your salvation. You can't rely on it to keep your salvation, because it ultimately curses us. Because cursed is everyone who doesn't continue to do everything written in the book of the law. It's a way of saying, unless you can keep every command, always, every command always, then you're guilty. We're pretty good as God's people. We're pretty good at recognizing guilt. At least I am. I can recognize when someone's guilty, when someone's doing something wrong. In fact, unfortunately, we tend to be quick to judge others as guilty, to judge others as villainous. We'll take big groups of people and we'll say, okay, this group of people, you know, maybe this is the group of people, these are atheists and agnostics, we're going to put them in this group. And, you know, just like in the old Westerns where the bad guys wear black hats, you know, and the good guys always wear white hats, we're going to put black hats on all these people over there. And then, okay, well, over here we've got, you know, drug abusers and prostitutes. Let's put black hats on them too. And we love to put out black hats, you know, dole out our black hats. And in our minds, we're tempted to think of ourselves as wearing a white hat because we're pretty good at doing the right thing. Notice I said pretty good. But if we want to be truthful, Paul's saying, look, that's all wrong. You've got it all wrong. I mean, keeping the whole law all the time. I mean, let's look just at three of the Ten Commandments. Do not murder. You know, most of us might think we've got that one covered. Do not commit adultery. And then I go with something like honor your mother and father, and many of us start to realize, whoops, I haven't always done that, have I? But then we look at Jesus' words in like Matthew 5, the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus points out it's a heart matter. It's not only what you do, it's what's in your heart. And therefore, if you've even ever lusted after someone, you're guilty of adultery. Well, that puts probably all of us out right there. And if you've ever been unrighteously angry at somebody or hated somebody, you're guilty of murder. Again, we're all gone. We're all guilty. We want to take the black hat thing seriously. We got to put black hats on every single one of us in here. We're all villains in the story. We're all wearing black hats, and there's only one person with a white hat, and that's Jesus. Jesus is the hero. The rest of us are villains. And Paul would say, until we've got that right, then we don't have a good grasp of the true gospel. Until we recognize as Jesus as the only hero of the story, then we don't have the gospel. So we can't rely on what we do, because Paul says, look, you can't keep it perfectly. So no matter what, you're a villain. And so you must rely on Christ. So we see that relying on works, it makes you cursed. But what we also see is that relying on works, it just doesn't fit. It doesn't fit with the story of God's people. Relying on rules and regulations to get us to salvation, it's not the way anyone has ever been declared righteous. And Paul points that out. Verses 15 and 16, and this is where it gets kind of heady here. It gets kind of intellectual here. It says, brothers and sisters, let me take an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or add to a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. Scripture doesn't say and to seeds, meaning many people, but and to your seed, meaning one person who is Christ. Now your translations, it might actually say offspring there. Quite literally, the word is seed. Seeds is a lot easier to say than offsprings. I don't know. But the argument here, he's actually going back to Genesis 3. And this is actually called the seed promise. And this is what the Jews were looking for. Genesis 3, it's where Adam and Eve, they rebel against God. The fall of mankind. And God yet makes a promise, doesn't he? He says to Eve, through this woman, through you, Eve, through your offspring, or through your seed, is going to come one that will defeat the serpent. It's going to come one who defeats the serpent. And that language of seed or offspring is actually continued through all of Genesis. And it's really, really interesting to follow how that word is used through Genesis. But we see it again in Genesis 12. And we see the promise, or actually through all of Genesis, actually in Genesis 22 is what I was thinking of just now, that it says, all nations will be blessed through your offspring, through your seed. And Paul's argument is, it doesn't say through your seeds. It means the only way that all nations can be blessed is through one seed, through Jesus Christ. Paul's point here is that it all points to Jesus. That what has been talked about through all of Genesis is this offspring that you will be blessed through. And that actually it's the offspring, it's Jesus who receives the blessing. And that's why only through faith in the one who actually gets the blessing, it's the only way that we can get the blessing, because we become one with him. So he goes on, verses 17 and 18. What I mean is this. The law, introduced 430 years later, doesn't set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. But God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise. Why then was the law given? It was added because of transgressions until the seed, that's Jesus, to whom the promise referred, had come. The law was given through angels and entrusted to a mediator. A mediator, however, implies more than one party, but God is one. So in other words, Jesus Christ coming is he that makes him the ultimate mediator here. Here's what Paul's saying. God made this covenant with Abraham. We've looked at covenants before. Way back in February, we were looking at God's covenant and how he made this covenant with Abraham. God makes this covenant with Abraham, and he gives them these promises. You know, I'm going to bless you. And those promises, they were made only because Abraham was faithful, right? That's the only reason he was going to get the promises. And Paul's argument here is, so when Moses gave the law 430 years later, it doesn't get rid of that promise that was originally made. That promise is still there. It's not the law that gets you the blessing. You can't obey the law to get the blessing. It still comes by the way that Abraham got it. Only through faith. Only through faith. The Judaizers, here's what they were doing. They were taking this one part of the story, all about the law, and taking that and accepting that while ignoring the rest of the story. Ignoring God's story about how he called Abraham out and how Abraham was righteous only because of his faith, they ignored all that stuff and only took the law. And that's a dangerous thing to do when you begin to take one part of scripture and just ignore everything else. There was a guy who tried to do that, a guy who was looking for God's will for his life. I want to know, don't we all? Want to know. Exactly. What do I do, God? What is your exact will? Very specifically, in lots of detail, please. What is your will for my life? And so this guy, he decided to go to Scripture. That's a good start, right? He went to Scripture to find out God's will for his life, and he decided to do this. I'm going to go to the New Testament, and I'm going to flip to a random passage. I'm going to close my eyes, and I'm going to point. And so that's what he did. Flipped through the New Testament, closed his eyes, pointed to a random verse, and it was Matthew 27, verse 5. Judas went out and hanged himself. Yeah, and that's exactly what he did. He said, ooh, and so he tried again. Something's wrong there. He tried again, he closed his eyes, points to a random passage. It's Luke 10, 37. Go and do likewise. One more time, he tries. John 13, 27, points to it. What you are going to do, do quickly. He obviously looking at one portion of Scripture without taking the rest into account, it can be very, very dangerous. Actually, that's, you know, cults like Jehovah's Witnesses and like Mormons, when they, these are some of the cults that use the Christian Bible to try to build their theology on. But the problem is what they do is they take a few verses, a few passages, and they try to build their whole theology out of these few passages instead of taking the whole big picture of the Bible. And it's very destructive, and a lot of people are just completely taken off of the right path of the gospel because of people who, false teachers, who are teaching teaching them based on not the big story of Scripture, but based on just little passages that they take out of context. And that's why it's important for us always, when we're reading our Bible, to understand the context, what's going on here, and what has happened previously, and to familiarize yourself as best you can with the bigger story going on in Scripture. So this idea that obeying rules and regulations can save you, it doesn't fit with the big story. That's never how it was taught. A lot of people have the false belief that, hey, back in the Old Testament days, if they followed the law, they would be saved, and that was the only way that they could be saved. That was never taught to them. It was always belief in God, looking forward to this promise. This was always the way that you were considered to be righteousness. So we see that. But, and then the final thing that we see here is that relying on works, relying on these rules and regulations, they can't give life. Rules and regulations, works, can't give life. Verses 21 and 22. Is the law therefore opposed to the promises of God? Absolutely not. For if a law had been given that could impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. But Scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin, so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe. That because of Jesus, we have life. Paul's saying, hey, the law is not bad, but it falls short because it cannot give life. Only Christ can give life. And that's why Christ is necessary. So we began by looking at all these foolish people, foolish beliefs, and we've learned, of course, that it's really foolish to depend on rules and regulations to get us by, rules and regulations to make us think that we're okay with God, as long as we're following these rules. It doesn't matter whether you're a new baby Christian or whether you are a well-experienced veteran Christian, if you know your Bible a lot or if you kind of just know it a little bit, what comes through loud and clear is faith. Faith is what's important, and that we must live by faith only. But what's that really look like? I mean, what does it look like truly to live by faith? If we really think about it, and if we really are familiar with our Bibles, we see that faith ultimately looks a lot like obedience. Faith looks a lot like obedience, except the priority is in the right place. We can take a command like tithing. We can look at something like tithing and how God calls us to be sacrificial givers. And we can focus in on the rule of that. And God's rule says that we have to give sacrificially. And so by God, I'm going to give sacrificially. But if we focus on the rule, we're ultimately going to fail because that's not really the right attitude to be giving with. But instead, we look at it from the point of view of our faith. What does the Bible teach about God? The Bible teaches us that God loves us very, very much, that he sacrificed for us, of course, sacrificed his son, but it teaches us that he meets all our needs. Every single need that we have, that he will meet it. And he's very concerned for even our individual lives, and he takes care of us, that he's a shepherd. Faith equals believing with trust. That means we not only understand it, but we believe it. I believe that God cares for me. I believe that he's going to meet every need. So I'm not afraid to give sacrificially because I know that he's got it covered no matter what. See the difference there? It's not so subtle, is it? The difference is in the heart of the matter, in the faith. we could say the same thing with a topic that maybe isn't as fun to talk about, and maybe is a little bit uncomfortable to talk about, but we could say the same thing for something like sexual sin. And we could think in our minds, okay, well today, you know, I'm going to get up and I'm going to only look at the opposite sex this way. Or I'm going to, you know, I recognize that I'm having a relationship that is not honoring to God, and so I'm going to stop doing this today. Or I understand I'm looking at this on the computer, but I'm going to stop doing this today. We can think like that, but ultimately, that's not the correct view of Scripture, is to go and say, hey, today is the day that I stop doing this. The correct view of Scripture is to put our faith in Christ. And when we do that, here's what we read. We read that sexual pleasure, it's good. It's a good thing between a husband and a wife. And it's an important part of the marriage covenant. And the marriage covenant is very, very important to a man and a woman. And that anything outside of that, any kind of sexual relationship outside of that, is destructive. It's destructive to the other party. It's destructive to us. And we see very clearly in Scripture that it's completely destructive. If we truly believe that, if we truly believe that God has our best interest for us within that marriage covenant, then we will begin to live our lives that way. And so it's a matter of how we place our focus. There's a famous hymn called Trust and Obey. Some of us might be familiar. Trust and obey, because there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Might be better if we rephrase that just a little bit. That's okay for us to say for a hymn. It's not okay for us to say in the Bible, hey, I don't like this verse, let me rephrase it a little bit. Maybe it could be rephrased to something like, if we trust, we will obey. If we truly have faith, if we truly live by faith, we will obey. If we're not obeying God, if we're disobeying God, what it's really doing is exposing a lack of faith, a lack of trust, that he's a very good God and a very powerful God. We're going to close today by looking at a video about trust and the difficulty of really living by faith, of really trusting God in all that we do.
Jesus, I just don't trust you.
You don't trust me?
No, I mean, I want to trust you, I just don't.
I have an exercise that I think will really help.
Oh, okay.
Stand here and face this direction. Mm-hmm. Now, do you trust me?
No, I just said I don't trust you.
All right, well, this is all part of the exercise.
Oh,
all right.
Right. Okay.
Whenever I ask you if you trust me, you say, yes, Jesus, I trust you.
Even though I don't.
It's practice.
Okay.
So, do you trust me?
Yes, Jesus, I trust you.
Now, fall back.
Are you going to catch me?
Don't worry about that part.
Okay, that's the part I'm worried about.
You can do this, okay? Just trust me.
Trust you.
Fall back.
Okay, well, Jesus, I trust
Good.
You. Yes, I do trust you. I'm gonna fall back.
Okay. Woo! Oh, okay.
That's great.
Okay. Let's try this again. Just face this direction and keep your feet planted. Okay. All right? Do you trust me?
Yes, Jesus, I trust you.
Now, fall back.
Okay. I'm gonna do it.
All right.
I'm really gonna do it.
Okay. Good.
Oh, Jesus, you really caught me! I didn't think you were gonna catch me, but you did!
Oh, that was great!
That was great!
You're ready for level two!
Level two, here
yes.
I come, baby! Woo!
No.
Whoa!
Okay, hold it.
Oh, you know what? You're too close. You need to move back.
Ah, right.
Okay.
This one's a little bit different, Laura.
Oh, okay.
Stand here.
Uh-huh.
But face me.
Woo! Forward fall.
Okay.
I can do that.
Wait.
Whoa.
Okay, wait for my signal.
Oh, right, the Jesus signal.
Yes, the okay. Jesus signal. Do you trust me?
Yes, Jesus, I trust you so much.
Good. Fall back.
That's awesome.
It is awesome. Especially when you do it.
Seriously?
Of course.
Okay, Jesus, I don't know if you noticed this, but there is nobody over there.
I know it looks that way to you.
It looks that way. It is that way.
You can do this, Laura. Just trust me and fall back.
Jesus, I can't do that.
We can do it together.
I can't.
You can.
I won't.
Living by faith is sometimes scary, but we must remember, Paul would encourage us to remember that since Christ is our only hope, we must live our lives by faith in Him only. Let's pray. Father God, we recognize that we can't do it on our own. We recognize that it's only by faith in You that we could ever come even close to be considered righteous. And God, we ask that You help us to really understand, to really get it in our hearts, that every day, day to day, that we got to live by faith only, not depend on these little rules and regulations and get so caught up in rules and regulations that somehow we fall into the belief of thinking that they're getting us somewhere with You, because we know that that's just not true. But only by faith. Only by faith are we saved. Only by faith can we continue this walk with You. We ask You to be with us. And God, if there's a decision that someone needs to make, we ask that You give them the